Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I rise in opposition to what was formerly called right-to-work legislation, but today we're calling it workplace freedom. Because, you know, right-to-work didn't pull so well in the state of West Virginia recently, so we changed the name. Now, we know that freedom isn't free. What's the cost? Your wages, your benefits, your way of life. We do get some freedoms from this bill. The freedom of the government to intervene with a private right of contract. I know we talk about numerous times down here how we want to scale back the government. This bill does the exact opposite. It also provides the freedom to get something for nothing. Now, many in this body would probably call that welfare. Don't forget the freedom also to get the exclusive representation, as the gentleman from the 50th talked about when it comes to the exclusive representation derived from the NLRA and the evisceration of the Union Security Clause, which will simply eat away at the unions from the inside. That is the intent and the effect of this bill. You know, we've been dealing with the propaganda for months now. Back in interims, we had two studies and trains of thought to go off of. One, we started in interims. James Shirk came in from the Heritage Foundation, speaking of propaganda. And his theory was, he even acknowledged, yes, wages will decline. But that's okay, guys, because when wages decline, studies show that right-to-work states have a lower cost of living, because that should be a goal for us. If that's the case, why are we even here? Why don't we just move to, say, Pakistan, or India, or maybe the sunny beaches of Mexico? And, Mr. Speaker, congratulations, we finally do have an immigration bill. Because as we drive down wages, we will drive in illegal immigrants from Mexico to come work in our great state. The second study that has been alluded to many times here today, the WU study. Now, it's a flagship university, and I'm a proud alumnus. And I can't disagree. There may be a 0.4% job growth. How? Because you're going to be working two or three jobs to survive after we drive down your wages. That's where the job growth comes from. We've heard about the history. I think you hear on the campaign trail, I'm sure many of you recite it all the time. Well, I'll never forget where I come from. Never forget where I come from. Let me tell you where you come from. In 1950, we had well over 2 million people living in our state. Union membership was 36% of the workforce. Fast forward, we've lost over 250,000 people. In 2016, guess where union membership stands today? 10%. As unions grow, we grow. As unions grow, our state grows. The history doesn't stop there. That has been alluded to earlier. We come from the Matewan Massacre. We come from the Battle of Blair Mountain, where the bloodshed that was alluded to earlier in the mountains of West Virginia led to national change. It led to worker equality when we said enough is enough. You deserve the right to earn a living. You deserve the right to collectively bargain. You deserve to have a chance and have a voice. And we should not be taking it from you. That's where we come from. And then the next argument will be, well, Sean, you know, things have changed, and unions just aren't needed anymore, because you're talking about old history. How about some current history? 2006, Sego, 12 miners dead, non-union mine. 2010, Upper Big Branch, 29 miners dead, non-union mine. That's recent history. That's West Virginia history. So where do we stand as a body? Do we stand for coal miners, as we talk about all the time? Or do we stand with coal barons? Do we stand with coal miners? Or do we stand for coal script? You tell me. We are better than this. You deserve better than this. Let's quit playing politics. Let's play policy. Policy is hard. It requires actually sitting down, having conversations, trying bipartisanship, and getting things done for West Virginians. Politics is easy. It requires putting a creative craft title on a bill, like establishing workplace freedom, throwing some junk poll with junk signs attached to it out to the citizens of West Virginia and say, well, I think 60% of the people want this. That's how we do things here. It's embarrassing. You deserve better. But as the poll numbers go, and you know, let's be frank here, Don Blankenship probably supports this, and he's facing prison right now. But I assume that we'll be back here soon drafting a Don Blankenship get out of jail free bill.
Gentlemen will keep his remarks to the bill in front of us. And
as far as poll numbers go, Mr. Speaker, I'm almost done. As far as poll numbers go, I think the poll numbers of the majority will be changing come November if we pass this legislation.